Hello, it's Brad Laurie, or Blockchain Brad. And yes, you've seen this before twice now. We are talking about Eureka and everything that's to do with validation, everything that's to do with copyright, and everything that's to do with big business on the blockchain to make sure you're protected if you want to create something right now. So we have the CEO, his name is Harsh, here to explain in part three all things about blockchain business.
Hi again, Brad. Good to be here.
Likewise. Now, we haven't changed clothes because we've done all these part threes in one day, and you're going to see them over a very, you know, very focused series. So perhaps these are going to be strung out over days, but that's so that you can have, you know, a focused experience and learn different parts and facets of Eureka. Now, in transparency, I certainly do not own any of these tokens, and I definitely want to, in the sense of I would like to invest in this company for the long term. Absolutely. So that's important, you know, and this is entirely free as an interview as well. So Harsh, thank you again for making the time today. Again, you know, from the conversations we've had, it's all about being transparent and digging deep and being real and being objective. And I think we're doing that very well in the last two. So let's keep going. Now, you have a business sort of background as well. We've talked about that with your credentials beyond the engineering, with your business degree. Very well educated in that sense. So I'm going to talk less about this and you more, hopefully. Do you want to give us a bit of a picture of just how important business is to this, the business experience, because you won't be able to build this without it?
Yeah, no, definitely. I mean, I think I talked in part one about, you know, my intersection of technology, business, and investing. And I would say that my journey led to technology first from engineering, and that startup I built and sold to my co-founders. I ran businesses and built them for years. And for the last couple of years, I've been managing the managers and largely investing in equities around the world, in crypto and real estate and a bunch of things. And that broad spectrum of experience and the associated network I've built, I think will be useful for this Eureka journey that we're on. And in part one, for example, I talked about Tom Hunter and how with one phone call and one meeting, he was able to, you know, we were able to attract a really, really good advisor who deals with internationally recognizable names in the music space. And that's just one example of what the business experience can do. So, you know, a lot of people in this space will ask things like, how many hours are you working on this? Are you full-time? What else do you have on the go?
Right.
And to them, let me ask you this. Would you prefer we hire someone for 120, 150 grand to pick up the phone and try to get past the gatekeeper to that person we signed up as an advisor and maybe have one call to introduce himself and hopefully sell him on another meeting? Or would you rather have someone like Tom Hunter, you know, maybe Tom's, you know, probably spends at least 20 hours a week on this, pick up a phone, call him, set up a meeting, one meeting,
close, exactly.
You know,
and
the relationship.
You know what? It's really rhetorical, you know that, because if you had me as an advisor, there's nothing I could do in that world like him. That's just the reality. And we have a lot of advisors in the crypto sphere solely and wholly for the advisor, the crypto world, as you know, and they have an endpoint. And unless they can bridge the gap and reach the gap, then there's a challenge. They are very valuable, but they can only do so much. You are really making sure you have the best of both worlds with the support from those early on. But most importantly, you have those direct conduits to big business, big names, big people. So this is the fun one I wanted to do, part three. Let's go. Come on. Let's dig deep a bit more than just Tom. You know a lot more about the advisory board and what's coming, the kind of connections, without saying names, or if you want to, go for it. I've signed an NDA to make sure that, you know, I can't say too much and certainly don't have any information about that. But if I did, I wouldn't be able to say out of respect and following an NDA. But you decide what you want to do. So let loose. What can be said about this advisory team?
Well, I mean, the advisors we have right now are on the website, excluding the one we just signed up. Okay. This board is going to be, we're targeting around 8 people. We just signed the first one. We're about to sign the second. And these people are going to be people who have spent decades in their respective area working with creators that we think would be important to get on the platform. So this particular person was very, very, has worked with big names in the music industry. Like I said, you'll
like
recognize
what?
The names.
Such as.
All right, you're really pushing me here. I mean, we're gonna actually talk about this closer to TGE, but okay. Let me pull up his
website. Give us something, you know, fine.
Okay.
Give us a teaser.
Okay. All right, I'm going to actually give you three names, something your kids would like, something you would like, something okay. your parents would like.
I love it.
So your kids, Ariana Grande.
Okay, my kids, I've got two girls who love her, okay.
Okay, Nicki Minaj.
Okay,
or big name. Elton John, like older, maybe Elton John.
Yes, my wife is a massive fan, so you hit the mark. Okay, so you now you're bragging. These are massive names, and these are people that are directly connected with this person.
Well, this person's company has done work with these clients or clients like this. So, that, I mean, and again, I want to set the expectation. I told in the Ferrum interview, we do have connections to recognizable names, but we want to walk before we run. We want to deal with the closed beta, maybe less recognizable names, and grow from there, put a better foot forward.
And, you know, I think you're going to be running before you intend to. That's the truth. I mean, when we look at part one and part two, and we've unpacked the token, you know, nuances of that. When we look at all the different utility and real use cases, we look at what you are holistically and the fact that you're the first mover, you know, in the whole holistic approach you're taking to validation of content creation and, you know, just digital assets all the way to NFTs. I mean, come on, this is going to be huge. This is potentially going to be really big. So if and when rather the TG happens, it's going to be a major thing. That's my view. Do you sense that? And if so, why? You know, what have you done so far to make sure that people are aware of this TG that's coming? Because, you know, my experience in the blockchain so far, these kinds of real utility proven teams, they get attention pretty quickly.
Yeah, so again, we have a methodical plan. We understand that in this space, it's important to get the word out, and there are a lot of channels to do that. We just recently started onboarding some of those channels, and we have a systematic approach. I mean, like, for example, this advisor, yeah. We probably let you guys know more details closer to TGE. That band member from the band that has the number one hit of the year on the Billboard 100 hot hit.
I'll be list. Googling. I mean, what year do I need to Google?
There'll be information about that. There'll be information about the sculptor who's been commissioned by cities to do large works. We will start letting that out in a systematic approach leading up to TGE. And you'll see that from now until TGE, I mean, I don't know what metric you want to use, Twitter followers, people in our Telegram channel. You're going to see a systematic build from now until TGE. That's the plan. Okay. And we are actively signing up work and people and validators for the closed beta. That's really the goal. Mm. So, you know, obviously getting the word out is a big part of the game in this space. And we do have a plan for that. I mean, that's why I'm spending time on interviews. I was with you, Kids on the Blockchain and Ferrum. Yes. Now with you.
Yes. And, you know, in transparency, I mean, some of these launch approaches, you know, with the marketing systems that are in place, they can be really valuable. You know, I talked about the Foundry as once before giving them a plug, because when you're transparent, when you have parties who are involved in this particular entity that are willing to essentially put their money where their mouth is, you know, I think there's a lot of value in that, because that longitudinal support, whether you're an influencer, whether you are, you know, an educator, whether you are someone for the future of this, it really is all aligned if you're all long-term and transparent. You know, that's one thing that's been really lacking in this space as well. So kudos to you for making sure you align with the right people, I think, in this instance. Because we just want to see real utility and long term. That's all that matters. You know, again, you know, we see those serious pump and dump risks of certain, you know, platforms that exist or certain, you know, alliances people make. How did you deal with that in the business sense now? If we're talking about protecting the image, protecting the TGE, protecting the future, everything. How did you navigate through this when you really didn't know that much about crypto in the beginning?
Well, I talked about this in two articles I wrote. I wrote an article on LinkedIn to announce my entry into crypto called A Value Investor's Journey into Crypto. And then I recently wrote one on Medium about our first NFT, thanking two very important people. Mm-hmm. So the first was Ian Friend from Ferrum. Even before, you know, in the early days, when it was just an idea, we were building out the team, Ian was very giving with his time. He's, you know, truly not very transactional, just wants to help, very giving with his time, network experience. And so dealing with Ian and Ferrum was a natural logical extension. Mm-hmm. The other person is Tyler Ward, who was the founder of Barnbridge. He recently right. passed over to a DAO, but you know, they're listed on Coinbase custody, and He, even while he was dealing with Barnbridge, was very giving of his time. And he was the one who told me, you know, kind of convinced me to get off the fence that I was leaning towards another blockchain option and to go on Ethereum. And I do agree with that. And he was also the one who said, you know, there's a lot of crypto projects that are actually going to pledge assets like their smart contracts, websites, white papers for protection. And particularly DAOs, they aren't registered entities. So how does a DAO own a white paper, a website, smart contract? So actually, as a byproduct of the minting process, it's a convenient way for them to hold it, transfer it when mergers and acquisitions become, you know, more commonplace in this space. So he was very helpful in that sense as well.
And, you know, you touched on something we have not talked about, and that's the potential to capitalize on the DAO movement itself. I mean, if they've got an anomaly there, you know, a bit of a conundrum, a crypto conundrum, literally, with ownership, because they're trying to espouse the DeFi movement and have a fully decentralized scenario. But in the interim, there is that chat question of who owns what and how it can be done. If you can redress some of those questions or address them and then redress some of the problems, I think you'd go so far in also supporting the DeFi movement. And with Barnbridge as well, when I was doing the research on you before we talked, I thought, wow, you're definitely going to tap into that narrative and that ecosystem of DeFi, because Barnbridge has done an exceptional job of that.
Definitely, and you know, we have access to Tyler and his knowledge and experience
and network. Contacts
and network. I mean, Tyler's a very giving person with those things, and he believes in us, and he's tweeted about that before. And so, again, outside of our regular real world business people, we do have connections in crypto, and it's growing actually daily. The number of people reaching out, the quality and experience of the people reaching out is actually been amazing.
I really wanted to talk to you about that, because when we first spoke, you know, I don't think that many people really talk about you and Eureka, but I feel like in the last few weeks, it's really been hot. The phone's been ringing. So tell us what that's been like. I mean, how has it experienced the interest, especially from the capital side of things? I bet there's people calling and wanting preferential treatment, wanting special in, get us in no matter what. Things like, what's going on? I'm fascinated by that.
Yeah, it's kind of weird actually getting bombarded with Telegram messages and emails and, you know, phone calls, texts. It's coming from everywhere. And, you know, like today, for example, it was really interesting. A guy reached out to my personal email. I don't know how he found it somehow. And he's like, I want to cut through the business clutter. I'm in Switzerland. I'm in banking. I could help you with, you know, the Bitcoin, the crypto community in Switzerland, which is like Silicon Valley for crypto. And, you know, we had a long discussion, and this guy sought us out. Guys from Dubai, places I would have, you know, I'm like, it's nuts. It's like a whole worldwide movement wanted to get in. And, you know, the challenge in this space is trying to cut through the clutter of who's reaching out because they see an opportunity to get in early and flip out and move to the next project.
Exactly.
And who actually is genuinely interested in what we're doing and wants to be along for the journey as a long-term partner.
Yeah, so how do you do that? I teach us all, because we all come up, a lot of the people who are in the top of, you know, crypto, which is really the average user. And we're all that kind of personality too, because we're all engaged in supporting utility or any functionality, whether it's governance, utility, or even the monetary aspect with Bitcoin. We all want to enfranchise something, and we stand for something in the use world. But when it comes to differentiating between the legit and shit, that goes from coin to people and everything in between. So how do you differentiate between those parties that, and I really do mean it when I say shitty people, if they aren't willing to stand up and support the very thing that they invest in, which is utility, long-term, you know, how do you work that out when they pitch so well, when they come up and say everything you want to hear and then possibly request preferential treatment? I mean, how do you deal with it? It must be so stressful to try and work out who, or do you rely on the transparency of the blockchain and the smart contract?
Well, it's a combination, but I mean, being in business for this long, I've learned to trust my gut a bit, and I don't always bet 100. We're going to miss some, but overall, I think, you know, I have a pretty good sense of who I think would be in it for the long haul and who aren't. And like I said, some people are going to slip through the cracks. We're going to get some wrong. That's fine. But I think I think we're kind of happy with people being reaching out and people who we choose to align ourselves with, and time will tell, I guess.
Well, you know, I read one of the things in your roadmap and it said that you're coming out of stealth, and I thought, wow, that's also a smart business strategy. And since part three is all about business, you know, did you really anticipate the kind of thing that is now the next phase? Because obviously we're pretty networked, you know, in this space when it comes to those parties that are privileged enough to have influence or to have educational value, or even, you know, you see the likes of VCs now and that anomaly where they're focused on influence as well. You see all the media investing in certain things and having biased, you know, opinions for their own bags. So it's a really funny space in that sense. And even though I do a lot of work with content that is not something I own, you know, and I really do embody that true educational thing, even I, you know, can be at risk even today, you know, with my disclosure that I want to invest in this, I'm at risk of bias. So how do you navigate that? You know, how do you go through this process and make sure that you build in the kind of people from every aspect to really build this out so you don't get dumped on? You know, is it because of the token metrics that you can guarantee that? Or, you know what I mean? Like, I'm really trying to get people to understand that you've built this in mind where you may have some cracks, you know, people fall through the cracks who are those that aren't as genuine as they seem. But for the most part, for the majority of people that they're going to pull through with this for the years ahead. And how long do you want to be with Eureka? Is this a 10-year, decade-long, two-decade-long? What, I mean, what's the plan in that sense too?
Okay, I'm going to be completely open like I have been throughout this whole thing. So any CEO who tells you they know for a fact no one's going to dump on them and it's going to just, no one knows for sure. But I can tell you is that just based on that LinkedIn article, we didn't solicit anyone. That we got people calling in who weren't in crypto, who want to participate. They meet the requirements, the legal requirements. They're going through the process. Those people aren't going to sell that
exactly
early. They're in it for the long haul.
They're the least likely, probably.
Exactly. So we do have a base like that, which a lot of companies don't. We haven't taken much VC money at all, and we probably won't. Mm-hmm. The people we choose to align ourselves with have expressed that and convinced us that they intend to be with us for the longer term. Whether some of them go back on that or not, who knows? We don't know for sure. So,
well, we'll know. We'll know from the blockchain. We will know. Well, you will know because, you know, that's the process. So at least, you know, one of the frustrating things is that no disclosures happen, you know, with the malacting because no one wants to upset the apple cart. So, for example, if a CEO has had a bad experience in the past, they may share that internally with another CEO, but they don't go and put it out in the blockchain. They don't put it out in the crypto media. And it's a shame, really, in one sense, because we want to get rid of those people who have a huge influence and don't truly stand up to believe in. That's what I think. So what are your thoughts on that?
Well, you know, like I hate to throw this out there again, but like everything, I think it's a balance, right? Mm. I mean, I will not fault someone if they come in early in a project like Eureka. They want to take some money and some profit off the table and they want to continue with the rest and let it ride.
Right.
I would like to see more transparency, but I won't be advocating for, if you aren't fully transparent and going out there and doing it, you're suddenly a bad person. I can't judge that, but it would be nice. It would be nice if more people did that. And I would support that. But by no means would I call anyone who doesn't do it a bad person.
Well, you know, you're a better guy than I because I'm not suggesting that. But I will say this is that my intention, you know, if I'm going to invest in this, is to be that long-term holder in this because you've got to get to that point where you have increasing utility and you can enable that. And that requires more liquidity. That requires more robust systems. So once you have that, then the token becomes available more and more valuable for that functionality. So that's another reason, you know, if you've got these people who dump early, perhaps it can be a great thing. It injects it into the market, allows smarter people to pick it up and really just support that utility anyway. So it could be a win-win for you in that sense and a loss for them if they don't see the vision.
I agree. And at the end of the day, it all comes down to what Buffett says. You know, price and value often diverge, but over the long term, they end up crossing paths. So as a business, all we could do is continue to build value and know that at some point, the market's going to recognize the value that we're building and the price is going to reflect that. And yes, we have no control. Other than that, we don't really have that much control over the price. And
that's the beautiful thing. You actually don't, you know, to clarify that. And that's for Tom as well. I'm going to say very clearly is you do not have the control over the price because at the end of the day, it's dictated by usage. It's by dictated by uptake, and it's dictated by real use cases of these scenarios we're talking about. So that's the real exciting thing, is the scope. Now, in a business sense, you've already hinted at some of those huge names we don't know about in the advisory role, but let's talk about potential clients. Let's talk about potential verticals. Let's talk about, like, let's open this up so far beyond the advisors. Let's go where people really haven't gone before. Talk about how big could this be as a company around the world, based on just the potential of different verticals, different people engaging in this platform.
Okay, let's dream a little bit here. So yeah, I'm going to paint a picture of what actually was described in part of our patent filing. So I was watching over the Christmas holidays, I was watching a movie, Disney movie called Soul with my kids. And there was a character in there, and I was thinking to myself, you know, that character can be reused in other movies. What if that character was verified and minted as an NFT, and people in developing nations could buy fractional ownership or a piece of it? Maybe Disney sells 20% to people in developing nations, and they, almost like a manager, earn fees every time that character is used in another movie.
Wow.
These are the kinds of things that this, you know, this platform can one day grow into. Are we going to get there this year? Absolutely not. So anyone watching, we're not going to get there this year. But this is the part of the opportunity set that we're fortunate to be a part of.
And could this also break down some of the legacy models that are problematic in terms of monopolies or duopolies, depending on the industry? I reference people who have been in the media as artists right across in different creative arts verticals, where they haven't been savvy enough, perhaps, or haven't afforded the rights to their own work. And we're talking about big artists who have had this problem too. Could this redress some of the monopolistic sort of design of the old legacy model?
That's absolutely what's drawing a lot of the artists that are coming to us to the platform, to put the power back in the hands of the people.
Right.
Other people, managers and stuff, they need to get paid. They should get paid, but they should get paid on the creator's terms. And they should determine who gets paid what. And over time, I think that that's something that we can help address for them.
Absolutely. And, you know, when we're talking about influence, that's when we talk about it, when it's at that level. You know, when we're talking about the power of the world's artists, you know, the big names, imagine the flow-on effects of that. We've seen the likes of, you know, Elon Musk with his moves in Bitcoin and, you know, his comments. We've seen the likes of Logan Paul with NFTs. And really, that's just the beginning, I think. Like, 2021 is the start of the awakening of, I guess, the globe through these artists and through these, I guess, these content creators to bring to the fore what's about to happen. And you're literally part of that first wave of movement that's exciting. With regard to integrations and partnerships, let's pull it back to the cryptosphere for a moment. Now, Barnbridge was one we've talked about, a very important strategic, you know, connection there. Are you going to announce things that are meaningful partnerships in any sense, whether they be strategic for business, whether they be strategic for the technology itself in any way? Obviously, connections with Ethereum there. Because I would hope that you're not going to announce any kind of hype-driven, you know, partnerships that really mean nothing, like we've seen.
No, I mean, so a lot of projects say, you know, we partner with UTrust. Really, we're actually using UTrust on our platform. We're working with them. They will accept crypto payments, Bitcoin, Ethereum, Dash, Tether, so you can pay with crypto or fiat. So that, you know, some projects announced that we're working with them. I don't know if we're going to put that out there or not. And then I don't know if you saw the announcement today, but we announced that VersoView, they're actually pledged their assets, their creative assets, white papers, smart contracts, website, to be validated during our closed beta. And you're going to see more of that, other crypto projects until closed beta, being announced that they're also pledging assets. Specifically with VersoView, though, what those guys are working on with their AI-powered platform for creating like 2.0 version digital magazines, there's going to be a very exciting announcement that they'll make with a major client, and that digital piece will also be validated on our platform.
That's interesting.
So look for that as well.
That's good to know. I mean, I spoke with Alex, as you know, and I spoke with the CEO, or the one of the co-founders, and I don't own any of that token. That's just absolutely true. And I did that entirely free, but it was really interesting to hear how they're forging ahead with their PER technology. And that, I thought that would align actually with you because of their focus on publications and engagement and rewards. But once again, that validation is everything. You know, you've got to have that seamless underbelly, much like you need credentials for the blockchain, as we see with Kilt, for example. It seems to be all of these very simple things that haven't been so simple to inject until now to make everything more safe and more seamless and, most importantly, more usable. Like, finally, we have these safeguards in place that we haven't had. So in that sense, let's talk a little bit more about, I guess, the team. That's one thing we haven't in any of the parts. Now, if you could just think of the, we talked about Tom's, so I think that legal's covered. And we talked about some of the specifics in the tech talk about the, like, the skill sets of the lead dev with the doctor that's on the list. But what about the others? You know, if we talked about business savvy, who are the ones leading this out with you that can push this to a whole nother level? And tell us a bit more about those advisors again in that context who are business driven that can open up the world to you, literally.
Yeah. So, I mean, there's one advisor who I tease some of his clients out there. There's another advisor we're very close to dealing with as well and signing on. That person's very well connected in the communities that pay artists. So that whole concept we talked about where Google and Facebook have trouble figuring out who to pay and how much, and they just like figure it out. That knowledge and expertise comes with that person. So we're very excited about that. You know, Matt on our team who we brought in, Matt has managed private funds of 100 million or more. And he's going to be very important as we give these monthly updates and dealing with the token holders and keeping them informed and things like that. And there's a lot more advisors that we have on the list, but it'll be premature at this time to talk about them. But suffice it to say, I think with our networks already, pretty much everything we'd want to get in touch with or any groups, we feel comfortable we can. Like, for example, on Friday, I'm meeting with some major influencers in Hollywood.
Wait,
Brad, this is our first meeting. It was through a contact of mine from Tampa that I've dealt with on a business level. But I'm just giving an example. Like, these things can come, will come.
And they come fast.
We're focused on the closed beta.
Yeah, but you know me, I'm always going to dig and annoy you a little bit when it comes to this kind of stuff because, you know, I don't like FOMO. I just love the fact that you're talking at this level and they're paying attention to the kind of scope here. And again, you're never going to escape the uncorrelated nature of the token and the performance of all the technology and even, you know, as you build out, because of all the hype that's going to happen, you just have to eventually deal with it in the short term, and then eventually things will peter out to be more logical and seamless as it moves out. But certainly, I think you're always going to have this situation in the beginning. We've never seen a legitimate company not have this problem, and it's a good problem to have, you know, quite sincerely. So when you're talking about these big names, and I can tell you don't want to even talk about it, and I'm just going to push a little bit, what do they want to do? Like, because they've got their celebrity status, is it because they want to capitalize on the position with the content that they create, or what is it when it comes to that kind of person?
So specifically, I could talk about the band. So the band was very interested in this platform that they can upload content, not worry about when to timestamp it, but timestamp it when they're ready, validate it when they're ready, and maybe with the NFT start monetizing it in interesting ways, maybe get paid through a smart contract and distribute the funds to, you know, the publisher and the manager and the band members and things like that. So that's kind of what they were interested in. And then our advisor with access to a lot more musicians is interested in similar things. But what we want to do is take the data from the closed beta and then figure out exactly who we want to bring on board and for what purpose. So I don't want the community to get like crazy excited when they see the names. Yes, we can do it, but we have a plan and we're going to roll it out in a methodical way. The folks from Hollywood, it's an introductory call. Mm-hmm. It was an intro through a mutual business associate that we deal with. We'll see. We'll just have a conversation. I actually don't know where it'll go. I didn't know where the conversation with the band will go, but it went much further than I thought.
Yeah, and you know, the reality is, I mean, this is selling itself in many respects, because you could actually be at the forefront of breaking down, again, those empires, those centralized entities that really don't give the artists, ironically, that much freedom and that much of an opportunity and that much chance to monetize in ways that it could literally change the game for them and really be a game changer for people who are just starting up in various industries as well. So, you know, no wonder this is going to be fire, I think, when it spreads around, if the reactions have already been very positive and move further on beyond, even with those you've mentioned who are number one artists of their time. And stop. It's getting ridiculous already. So we'll find out, in the next couple of months, just what we're talking about here. But I sense the reactions are just so much more than positive. They're so much more meaningful, and they surprise probably by what you're doing. Now, the roadmap to finalize this, you know, very interesting conversation, it kind of went from business and then a little bit to FOMO, my apologies. What's the thing that excites you most with the business side of this? You know, with the roadmap, obviously these big names are coming up and you're always very controlled to try and pull me back from trying to dig deep into FOMO land. But, you know, what's exciting about the business side of this that you think is going to be of value?
So, you know, when you build a startup, you really want to get to the point of solid product market fit, where the problem you're trying to solve is resonating in the target market, and you could see us closing business profitably and quickly. I didn't expect to get to a good, decent product market fit this quickly. Like, I expected artists to come and say, hey, my friend said we should check it out, but you know, we use this platform for this, we use this platform for the, why would we need you? And then I was prepared to talk them through that. I wasn't expecting these people to come and say, we see what you're doing, we love it, we want to support it, let us know what we could do. I've always heard that, you know, the artist community is very welcoming, loving, and you know, on board to work together. I'm actually feeling it now, and that is the most exciting part of this. And it's why I'm going out of my comfort zone to be, you know, more public facing, which, you know, is not really my thing. In past, I've actually paid not to do this. I don't like being the public guy, but I am that passionate about this.
Likewise. I mean, I've never done a series of three in one day like this before, and this will come out in a series of, you know, we'll release this over days because no one wants to listen to us for hours in one go. But honestly, what an absolute honor to speak with you. And I mean this not as a potential investor, not as someone who is thinking about the monetary side of this. I'm thinking about this in the long term for a real deal change that we can affect, you know, collectively, when it comes to allowing people to monetize better, to make it fairer, to make it more distributed, to make sure that this actually is a positive change in the business realm. And you're doing that with blockchain built in. So I wish you all the very best, Harsh, in this beginning. TGE for a plug is coming up soon. But what matters more, mate, is not the TGE, it's not the hype, it's not the FOMO. All that's going to happen probably for what you are. What matters is, you know, 6 months from now, 12 months from now, 2 years from now, when we catch up, and we're going to do a lot of that together, regardless of whether I'm invested or not, because it is about being transparent about what is good on the blockchain and getting real. You know, these CEOs like you that do this, you are changing the game because you're bringing information that we simply don't get. So I really appreciate your time. If you haven't checked out all the information about Harsh, about his team, about Eureka, make sure you check out the information below because it will be all there for you. But until next time, make sure you do your research, your due diligence, and look for those guys who are positioning themselves for the long term in crypto. Thank you very much, Harsh, for your time.
Appreciate it, Brad. I can't believe it. What is it? 2.5 hours flew by. Thanks a lot. Whew.
Amazing. We made it. And part 1, 2, 3 is coming soon. Thank you.